This is a piece of work which I've done in recent months, although it goes back to ideas about which I thought for a long time, and the title of the work is indeed Theory of Programs. It's a very pretentious title. Actually, a colleague to whom I showed an early version of the article on which this is based said I should at least have the modesty of calling it a theory of programs. He's probably right. Actually, the way I would really like to call it is a simple theory of programs, but then the acronym would be STOP, and to me it's more a start than a stop, so I have yet to find a good name. And why am I doing this? Well, I think that it's possible to talk about programming in a mathematical sense, in a much more simple way than everyone else is doing. So there are, of course, lots of theories of programming, from the basic theory of computation, Turing machines, to denotational semantics, axiomatic semantics, the unified theories of programming that Tony Hoare and Jifeng He have come up with. And what really strikes me is how complicated that stuff is. And it seems to me, and I'm going to try to show to you, that it is possible to talk about programming in a very simple way, using mathematical concepts that belong to high school, srednje škole, to 15-year-old, to this kind of stuff that we all learned when we were about 15, and there's no need to use anything more complicated than that. So this is the kind of thing I'm reacting against. There's a fairly famous paper by a whole group of people, it's useless if I can only shoot at you. It's kind of useless if I use this laser pointer. There's a whole, set of concepts, a whole set of laws by this group of people led by Tony Hoare. It's a paper that is already something like 15 years old. It's a good paper, it's a classic paper, and it attempts to come up with a set of laws that describe programming in general. And they have stuff like this. So they have this operator choice. So this is the operator. So it's choice between two instructions. You execute either P or Q. And so they have these beautiful properties. It's symmetric, P union Q. Oh, I said union, it's not union, it's choice, right? But it's written like union, so it's kind of tempting to say union. So P union Q, P choice Q is Q choice P, so it's symmetric. Then, I'm going to have to find a place to stand. I think I'll be better actually there. Sorry for this. Eventually I'll find my right place. But this is going to work better, I believe. Yeah. Right. So choice is symmetric. Choice is associative. Choice is idempotent, and there's one more property here. So, but on the other hand, it's written like union. So there's a reason why they use this symbol here. And when I look at this, I say, okay, this is it's very interesting, it's very attractive, but if it looks like union, it's written like union, it is symmetric like union, it associates like union, it distributes like union, and so on, maybe it is union. Maybe it is just a plain union that we know from high school. But it's not the way it's introduced, right? This is supposed to be a completely new operator which is defined axiomatically. Here's another example, another famous paper by Gilles Kahn, a great French computer scientist, and he introduced what he called natural semantics. He said it's a more natural way to talk about programming and programming languages than what everyone else was doing at the time. And he has properties like this. For example, this is the specification. Actually, these two properties here are the specification of if then else. Sorry, I'll get it right eventually. So, okay. It looks pretty scary, right? In fact, it's not that complicated, but still it has to be executed, to be explained. What it says is that if we have an environment row, so what's an environment? It's a map between variables and values. So row is defined for, think of a hash table, right, for a compiler. So in row is this association that tells us that value x has value, that variable x has value 3, that variable y has value 7, that variable b, which is a boolean, has value true, and so on. So that's what a row is, an environment, right? The mapping between variables and values. And so what it tells us is that if in this environment row, e1 evaluates to true, if you just interpret the complicated mathematical symbols in a simple way, and in this same environment row, E2 evaluates to alpha, then in this environment, in the same environment row, the conditional expression if E1 then E2 else E3 evaluates to alpha because E1 evaluates to true. And the next one is for the false case. Now, okay, this works, but it's very complicated to say something very simple, right? If I have to explain the notion of Boolean of a conditional instruction or conditional expression, what I would do is
first I would get the right window. Sorry, it's a bit. I definitely need three hands to do this. Yeah. Okay, and also need a mouse, which I cannot have. Right. So if I have to explain to someone what a conditional instruction is, I would draw something like this, you know, a set of cases. And then this is C, supposed to be C. The complement C prime, maybe I'll write them outside, C and C prime. Okay. And here we want to have E2, and here we want to have E3. Okay. That's what the conditional expression or a conditional instruction is. We have two cases, and depending on the case, we do one thing or we do the other thing. And all these notions of environment, all these symbols are just making something simple much more complicated than it has to be. And so this is kind of the start of this work, you know, to try to see if we can just explain programming in a simple way. Now, coming back to Tony Hoare in his paper, he cites Bertrand Russell. So, the approach that Hoare and actually Kahn and many other people use is an axiomatic approach. Axiomatic approach means you come up with a set of axioms, and then you hope that the axioms actually have a model, that they can actually, that they are realistic, that they can be fulfilled, or as we would say in programming, implemented. So for example, I don't know if I have it on a slide, no, but for example, you know, I could say here are a few functions. Let me call them C and S. And we have the property that the integral of C is S, the integral of S is minus C, and then C of X square plus S of S square is 1. So these are axioms, right? And then I could tell you, well, we call these functions cosine and sine. And so we have defined trigonometry axiomatically. But that's not the way we do it in practice, right? When we teach trigonometry to a 12-year-old, we explain these functions in terms of things that they already know. With the axiomatic approach, on the other hand, we just posit, we just assume, we just introduce a number of axioms, and then we expect that someone somewhere is going to show that it actually is possible. So Bertrand Russell, in a very kind of high-class British style, says that the axiomatic approach has the advantages of theft over honest toil. Как это сказать по-русски? Все преимущества жульничества над честной работой, да? Ну, да, да, sure, but maybe некоторые из нас предпочитают честную работу. Maybe some of us prefer think that in the end honest toil is better. So, you know, and they say, of course, the mathematician should also find a graduate student. It doesn't say graduate student, but that's what it means, to prove that there is a model. Well, okay, I don't think this is the right way to go. It's the right way to go if you are piano, right? Not this kind of piano, but piano, right? The guy who came up with the axioms for integers. So, you know, for maybe four or five fundamental concepts in mathematics, yes, we come up with axioms. But everything else is derived from things we know. And that's what I'm going to do now. I'm going to show to you, to try to show to you, that all the concepts that we know and love in programming can be derived from very simple notions of elementary set theory, emphasis on elementary, you know, 15-year-old stuff. Okay, so now we begin the actual specification. Now, you absolutely have to understand this slide. If you don't, it's very simple, there's only a few things on it, but if you don't understand it, if you don't follow this slide, then you are not going to understand anything else. So you're all following very carefully, but if anyone is browsing the web, posting to Facebook, Twitter, stop and listen to this, because this is the one place which, if you miss it, you're going to miss everything else. So what's a program? A program is the combination of two things, post and pre, a post condition and a precondition, as we are going to call them. And post is a relation, so I'm going to use this notation here, S, double arrow S, to mean the set of binary relations between S and S. So we have a set of spaces. So what's a program? Fundamentally, it's a post condition. We're going to add a precondition in a second, but basically, a program is a relation, so it says for value 1, we are going to get result 3. For value 7, we're going to get result 2. For value 1, we could also get result 4. So that's why it's a relation and not a, not a function, right? It could be a non-deterministic program. But basically, that's what we have. And so formally, the set of relations between S and itself is the power set of the Cartesian product of S by itself, right? So you could have a relation which is, for example, Charles, Elizabeth, Anne, Elizabeth, then Charles, Philip. So this is the relation parent limited to the, I'm sorry, I should write it like this. A set of pairs. It's the relation parent in the British royal family, right? Charles is the, or rather child. Charles is son of Elizabeth, Anne is the child of Elizabeth, Charles is a child of Philip, and so on. So that's what it means to have a binary relation, meaning a set of pairs. And if we had a program which computes the parents of a person, well, it would basically compute this relation, or at least for any particular element like Charles, it would give us the set of its parents. Okay, and next we have a set which we call the precondition, and it's the set of values on which we're going to be interested in applying the relation. So it's a subset of the set of values. Now, the need for the precondition doesn't appear immediately. It's going to become more clear as we go. So please just accept it for the moment. We are going to say that even though we may have a very general relation post, then we're only going to be interested in values
which satisfy pre, in arguments, I should say, which satisfy pre from the beginning. So a couple of notations. If we have a given program P, the postcondition will be written post sub P, and a precondition will be written pre sub P. And the other way around, if we have a post and a pre, this notation here with angle brackets is going to mean the program with the given postcondition and the given precondition. Okay, so there's something a bit shocking here. I said a program or specification. Well, we're used to accepting that a program and a specification are something, are two very different things. A specification specifies, it tells you what you should do, and a program is an implementation. It tells you how to do it. And here I'm actually saying that there is no fundamental difference between a program and a specification. They are the same concept. So why? Now, usually when people distinguish between program and specification, they say things like a specification is abstract, a program is concrete, or as I just said, a specification describes the what, the program describes the how, but this is all very vague. And the point here is that these are relative notions. So, for example, you take something like this, an assignment, right? Colon equal means assignment. Assignment instruction. So it looks like an implementation, right? It's looking like a program rather than a specification. But this is all relative, because if you are a compiler writer, this is your specification for implementing an assignment statement, and the implementation is going to be many different machine-level instructions, load, store, and so on. As another example, take this. Okay, we want to compute a result such that the square of the result is the input, x. So this looks like a specification, because the implementation is going to take some algorithm to compute a square root, like Newton's method and so on. But it's, again, all relative. There are lots of programming languages today, like Mathematica, you know, this kind of thing, where you can actually write this exactly as I wrote it, and the compiler is going to figure out the details and generate the right algorithm to compute the square root. And so these examples are in support of the point that there is no fundamental difference between specification and program. It's all a matter of relative distinctions. We cannot say that this is a specification, that is a program. That's meaningless. What we can say is that P1 is an implementation of P2. So then P2 becomes the specification and P1 becomes the implementation, the program, but that is a relative distinction, not an absolute one. And so a bit later on, I'm going to reintroduce the distinction between specification and program by having essentially two programs or two specifications, one of which is the implementation of the other. Then we have reintroduced the distinction, but as a relative distinction, not as an absolute one. For the moment, until I come back to this, in this discussion, program and specification mean exactly the same thing, and what they mean is this: the combination of a relation and a set. Any question on this? Is it symmetric?
Yes.
Postcondition? No. So the question is whether the relation between programs and specifications is symmetric. So could you make a relation? Could you make a program that is could you make a specification implementation?
So, x and 2, can you say that 2 is a specification of x?
That 2 is a specification of x?
Yeah. So if you take an abstraction of integers, and you will say that basically the integer is the abstraction of the set of integers.
No, not in that sense. But I'm going to introduce refinement in just a moment, and refinement is going to be exactly that property, and refinement is not symmetric. So, yeah, for anyone who likes pictures, this is the illustration of what I just described. So we have the set of states,
This is the big blue set here. And then we have the relation, and you can see that the relation here is represented by links from elements to elements, to from states to states. Actually, for good measure, I should also have a few links outside of, which originate outside of pre. It doesn't matter where they go. Then a picture, my picture is really messed up. But the reason I didn't have these is that we are only going to be interested in links that originate in pre, where pre is the precondition. Okay, so that's the idea. And yeah, this is post. We said that a program is deterministic if B, a program B is deterministic if it's a function. So for example, if I remove the duplicate arrows like this one originating from the same point, which calls non-determinism, then we get a deterministic program. In general, programs are non-deterministic, right? There's, for a given value, we could get several results. But if we remove the duplicates like this, then we get a function mathematically, and in terms of programming, we get a deterministic rather than non-deterministic program. So what's a programming language? Or a specification language, at this point it's the same thing. Well, these functions and relations, we're going to build them out of some basic functions and relations. And so a programming language is a set of predefined relations and combinators which enable us to get new programs from existing programs. And so usually people start with this. Usually people start with a programming language, and this is where you get things like environments, you know, like we saw in the Gilles Kahn paper. But this comes much, much later. It's not fundamental. Okay, this I can mention briefly. We said that, as already mentioned, that a program is deterministic if its postcondition is a function rather than a general relation. We said it is functional if there is no intersection between the inputs and the outputs. Okay, that's functional programs. We always go to new states. So functional programming people think they have no states, but in fact they have a state. It's just that the result state is state set is always disjoint from the input state. And object-oriented, that would be a bit more difficult to, or a bit it would take a little longer to explain exactly what it is. We won't need it at this point. But I'm going to use this notation. Please remember the notation, because I'm going to use it a lot. It's image. Now, when you have a relation, like for example here, if you take a set of values, then if you apply the relation to these values, you get a result set of values, which I think is this. And so if this is A, then R, and the relation is called R. R of A is the image that is to say the set of values that we get from elements in A. And I just use this very simple notation, R of A, which is the generalization of the standard function application notation. Okay, this we don't fundamentally need. Okay, this we do need. It's the notion of a program being feasible. We said that a program is feasible if pre is a subset of the domain of post. So I'm going to use, again, one more notation. I'm almost done with the notations. This is all more or less the last notation, or almost the last notation that I have to introduce. R domain and R codomain. So R domain, R underscore, R underline, is the set of values for which R is defined. And R overline is the codomain, that is to say the set of values that R yields. Okay? So we said that a program is feasible if its precondition is a subset of the domain of its postcondition. This is a very important property, and we're only going to concern ourselves for the rest of the discussion with feasible programs. What does it mean to have a feasible program? Then let me get back to the picture. If a program is not feasible, it means that I can have values here which satisfy the precondition, but for which there is no result. You know, here the program is feasible because for every element in pre, like all these elements here, there's at least one result, right? But if I had an element here, like the one I'm showing, with no value defined by post for it, then I would be in trouble because pre tells me it's okay. You can use the program for this particular value, but it's lying. It's lying because there is no result. So it's very important that we have this property of feasibility, which says once again that the precondition is a subset of the domain of the postcondition. In other words, if we satisfy the precondition, we're sure that we're going to get a result. Maybe several results if the program is non-deterministic, but at least one result. And final definition, after that we're going to start collecting theorems, right? So I'm doing a bit of preparation, but please bear with me for another 3 or 4 minutes, because after that, it's just going to be harvest time. We are going to go out and collect theorems by the dozen. Okay, so we say that P2 refines P1, so we have two programs, and I think this is coming to Professor Gelfi's question. We have two programs, P2 and P1. And I'm going to say that P2 refines P1, and yeah, I should have written it on the slide. We're going to write this as P2 refines P1 like this. Okay, but for the moment, it's just called refines. If basically the postcondition of P2 is a subset of the postcondition of P1, there's a couple of other conditions, but basically what it says is that any answer that P2 gives us is also an answer that P1 could have given us. Okay, once again, maybe using the word result rather than answer, any result that P2 gives us is a result that P1 could also have given us. Now remember that we're dealing with potentially non-deterministic program. So it's quite possible that P1 for a certain value gives us several results, like 2, for example. So this is X, this is Y, this is Z, and it's quite possible that P1 gives us both of these results because it's non-deterministic. And now let's assume that P2 only gives us Y. Then P2 is a refinement of P1. And any value that P2 gives us is a value that P1 could also have given us. On the other hand, if P2 gives us a value that is not in P1, then we're off. It's not a refinement. Okay, so it's a very simple idea. Now, the technical details are that we also must have the reverse relationship between the preconditions. Because what's possible if for P2 to accept more values than P1? That's okay. It doesn't hurt. What we don't want is that a value accepted by P1 would be rejected by P2. That would be wrong. And also, I said subset, but in reality, it's a bit too strong. You see this notation here. What does it mean? It means basically that post 2 is a subset of post 1, but it only needs to be a subset on pre 1. So this is this notation here. When I say R is a subset of R prime on X, it means that R restricted to X is a subset of X prime. And I said I had the last notation. I think this is really the last notation. I think it was on a previous slide. Yeah. I'm going to use restriction and co-restriction. So the concepts are very simple. R restricted to X is R but applied only to elements of X, where X is a subset of S. And R co-restricted to Y is the other way around. We only retain results in Y. So for R restricted to X, we only retain inputs in X. For R co-restricted to Y, we only retain results in Y. And that was really the last mathematical notation that we needed. So here, when we say R is a subset of R prime on X, it means that R is a subset of R prime. That is to say, every pair in R is also a pair in R prime. Right? Remember that relations are sets of pairs, right? So when I say R is a subset of R prime, I mean every pair in R is also a pair in R prime. But we only care about those in X. Outside of X, it doesn't matter. And that's exactly what we need here, because pre-2 might be bigger than pre-1. So we only care about a refinement on values that satisfied the original property. Okay, so now we are done with the mathematical definitions, and we talk about implementation. So what's an implementation of P? So you see the difference between program and specification somehow coming back. But I'm not introducing that definition yet, that distinction yet. I'm just saying that what an implementation is. An implementation is a refinement. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to start from something quite abstract and make it more and more concrete. That's to say, more and more close to what can actually be executed by a computer. But we're only interested in feasible refinements. And it's quite easy to come up with contradictions if you don't have this requirement of feasibility. Okay. And so here's a theorem, and I don't want to go into the proof, I'm just suggesting that a proof is there. The theorem seems trivial, but in fact it takes a few steps to prove, so it's not very difficult, but it's still not trivial. The theorem says that if a specification has an implementation, it's feasible. So that sounds obvious, right? Because if I can find an implementation, and it means I can actually obtain a solution to that problem. But in fact, the theorem is not absolutely trivial to prove. Okay, we said that an operator is refinement safe if it basically it preserves refinement. So what I'm going to do now is introduce operators on programs, right? Operators like if then else, like loop, like composition, and so on. And for example, if you have two specifications, S1 and S2, I'm going to define the composition of S1 and S2, which is execute S1 and execute something that does that satisfies S1, then execute something that executes S2. Now let's assume that we have a refinement of S1, which is a program P1, and P2 refines S2. Well, clearly we want the composition of P1 and P2 also to be a refinement of S1, S2, which is what this property tells us for not just for composition, but for any operator. So we are going to say that an operator is refinement safe if, when we combine two programs with this operator, we keep the refinement. That's basically what it says. Okay, this I'll introduce in a few moments. Okay, now we are going to start building programs. And it turns out that, as far as I can tell, all the programs of interest can be written with three operators. Here I've written, I've introduced four, but one is the last one is important in practice, but it can be defined in terms of the others. So we really have three operators on programs that are essentially the only thing we need to write any kind of programs whatsoever. Union, or choice, composition, and restriction. And then we'll also have co-restriction. And to define a program, we need a postcondition and a precondition. To keep things simple, I'm only including the postcondition. And in the paper, I also describe the preconditions associated with these operators, and you can actually guess them for yourself. Now, the choice or union is going to be written union, because that's what it is, and the postcondition is the union of the two. So P1 choice P2, this is the same as in the Tony Hall paper that I showed at the beginning. This is a program that behaves non-deterministically, either as P1 or as P2. Toss a coin and get tails or head. Then the composition. P1 followed by P2, it's the mathematical composition of post-1, post-2. So usually mathematicians write composition like this, right? G composed with F. I prefer to write it like this. It's the same thing. It's just a matter of notation. But for a programmer, it makes more sense because it emphasizes that we do F first and then G. But it's the same thing. It's just different notation. So if you have good eyes, you will have noticed that these operators here are written in red, right? So I'm cheating a little bit here because the red operators are the mathematical operators. They're just the set theoretical operators, union, composition, and such. And the blue operators are operators on programs, which are almost the same, in fact, as you can see from the definitions. So the next one is restriction. And here the notation is different. This is P, the program P, but applied only to C. So C is a subset of the set of states. And this is just the program P that we apply only on C. So mathematically, it's the restriction. Remember that slash here? This is the restriction. And we have the co-restriction in the same way. Okay, so now we've done our homework. We've done the hard part, and then comes the pleasant part. This is, previously we've had the appetizer, no закуски, потом первое блюдо, потом второе блюдо, сейчас будет десерт. And the dessert in this case is theorems, of course, is what we all want. So one of the problems that with a lot of theoretical theories of programs, it's that there's lots of definitions and very few theorems, right? And if you do mathematics, it's not to introduce definitions, it's to get theorems. So here are some theorems. So I don't know, can someone pick a number between 1 and 9? Alexandre, give me a number between 1 and 9. 7, okay. Just to explain, I'm not going to explain all of them, okay? But, well, this one is relatively straightforward. If we choose between P1 and P2, arbitrary choice, you know, we execute either P1 and P2, but we only take the results that belong to C. Well, it's like having a choice between the following two programs, one which applies P1 and only keeps the results in C, and one which applies P2 and only keeps the results in C. So you can do the selection first, the choice first, and then the co-restriction, or the other way around. That's what he says. Give me another number. Sorry? 4. Okay. 5. Okay, I'll do both. I'm a generous person. So number four. So if we execute P1, then P2, but we only do it on C, we only take inputs from C, well, it's like executing P1 but on C only, and then executing P2. And number five, so if we execute Q, then we execute either P1 or P2. It's like executing Q then P1 or executing Q then P2. Okay? And now, what's important, of course, is that even though I gave you programming explanations in terms of we do this, we do that, and so on, or we choose between this and that, what's important is that these are all operations on sets, right, which are all based on these basic operators, union, intersection, restriction that a 15-year-old can understand. You probably a 12-year-old can understand. So it's all mathematics. Okay, a few extreme programs, with not in the sense of extreme programming, but in the sense of exceptional borderline program. Skip. This is the program with the postcondition identity. It doesn't change anything. And the precondition is the whole set of states. So it's skip. Its identity doesn't change anything. It always works because the precondition is S, but it yields the input. Remember that this notation here means the program of postcondition post and precondition pre. Then you have havoc. Havoc is also, so havoc means случай, все, что возможно. Мы ничего не знаем о результате, но всегда будет результат. Или наоборот, всегда будет результат, но ничего интересного мы не знаем об этом результате. Поэтому havoc. So the postcondition is anything and any, you know, for any input we can get any output, so it's always defined, but we know absolutely nothing about the output. And then we have halt, which never works. Okay, we cannot take any input. So, lots of new theorems. Give me a number. Yeah, but I can count, actually. No. This is, I said it's 15-year-old mathematics. So, yeah, I can count. Six, okay. One, two, three, four, five, six. Okay. P followed by havoc. Well, if you follow anything by havoc, you get havoc. But you only get it for inputs that can be processed by P. So that's why the result is free sub P is havoc restricted to the precondition of P. Okay? So we could go over all, but, well, maybe let me give you one more. So this one. So what does this symbol mean here? The symbol I just circled. Ah. What does this mean? How do you read this aloud? Refines. Excellent. Who said refines? Who said refines? Okay. Oops, sorry. Swiss chocolate. Right, so if Q1 refines P1 and Q2 refines P2, then the choice between Q1 and Q2 refines the choice between P1 and P2. Okay? And the choice, and same thing for the composition. So you have all these problems. Now, what is interesting here is that if you look at the papers that I cited at the beginning, you get this kind of property. Although usually fewer of them, because people don't want to have 40 axioms, right? But they are introduced as axioms. And here we start from this very basic mathematical assumption, and we just get those as theorems. And theorems, most of which are trivial. Actually, not all of them are absolutely trivial. I should, by the way, say that I've proved everything that's in the paper. You can easily find a paper online, but I've proved everything manually. Yeah, I didn't run this through a machine checker, and so I've done it very carefully, but I cannot guarantee everything is correct. Okay, concurrency. So we have a first form of concurrency, which was written like this, And it's very simple. You see the definition, it says that running P1 and P2 concurrently is either running P1 and P2 or running P2 then P1. So it's very primitive, it's very disappointing, I know. It's kind of an interleaving at the highest level. So it's the first form of concurrency. Now, in practice, this is not usually what we want. We want more interleaving. So we have another operator, which is it's a ternary operator. It's an operator with three arguments. And it enables us to define the level of interleaving. It's written like this. So don't be misled by the notation. It's an operator between three operands, P1, P2, and Q. And it says, execute Q interleaved with P1 and P2. And so you see the definition. It's either P1 in parallel with Q, with a previous parallel operator, followed by P2, or P1 followed by P2 in parallel with Q. And it turns out that with this operator, you can get basically anything you like in concurrency. And in particular, it's a little low on the slide, but I'd like to bring to your attention this set of two properties, which in a more recent paper by Tony Hoare is brought in with a lot of fanfare as one of the fundamental axioms of concurrent programming. So Hoare wrote a paper a year or two ago with my former PhD student, Stefan van Staden, continuing the laws of programming paper, and this one is called the laws of parallel programming, or maybe laws of concurrent programming, I forgot. And they introduced this as a fundamental axiom, but in fact, it's just a straightforward theorem in this approach. Okay, next, conditionals. We either see one or, I'm sorry, either P1 or P2. So this is very, the basic one. So who's familiar with Dijkstra's Goddard commands? So you should. Read the old stuff, right? There's still lots of interesting stuff there. So this is a non-deterministic conditional. And you can see the definition. It says if on C1 execute P1, on C2 execute P2. What if we have an input which is both on C1 and C2? Well, it's non-deterministic. We don't know. So if you don't like non-determinism, you can use this version here. So that's the one we all know. If C, then P1, else P2. It's defined as on C1 execute P1, and on the complement of C, I'm sorry, on C execute P1, and on the complement of C execute P2. So C prime is the complement of C, so it's very simple, right? We have C, and on C1 we execute P1, on C prime we execute P2. On C we execute P1, on C prime, the complement, we execute P2. And it's a non-deterministic choice. But here, in fact, it is deterministic because C and C prime are disjoint. Okay, so now we have, the harvest continues. We have lots and lots of theorems, by the dozen. For example, let me choose one myself this time. The last one. If Q1 refines P, so Q1 is an implementation of P1, and Q2 is an implementation of P2, more generally refines, then we can refine if C then P1 else P2 by if C then a refinement of the first one else the refinement of the other one. Okay? So none of these properties is earth-shattering. But together, you can see that we have already had something like 30 theorems, which provide us with what Tony Hoare was calling the basic laws of programming. Now, you might also have noticed that there's no logic in all this, in the sense of Boolean logic, you know, propositional calculus, predicate calculus. Calculus, we don't need any of this. Actually, in this whole theory, we don't need logic. And usually, it's considered that in order to understand computer science, you have to study logic first, and I have nothing against this. But for this theory, we just need elementary set properties, union, intersection, and so on. Still, we're used to things like true and false. So they are not going to be Boolean values, they're going to be sets. We all work with sets. So true is just another name for the set of all states. False is another name for the empty set. And then and is intersection, or is union, implies is subset. So I think we all have this intuition that and is conjunction and so on, but this is making it formal. And then we have a whole new set of theorems. If we restrict P to true, remember that the colon here is restriction, then we're not restricting anything. If we restrict false to P, then we get halt, because it's never going to be applicable, and so on. Okay? And I think these two are actually more or less, in a simpler form, the properties that we had in the Kahn paper, in the Gilles Kahn paper. Remember this thing about conditional. Finally, loops. So as you can imagine, loops are a little bit more advanced, but they're still pretty simple. First, we define P to the power I, so that's I executions of P. For zero, it's skip, restricted to the domain of P. And then after that, it's P followed by PI. And then we have loop PN. So what's loop PN? It's not a construct that exists in programming languages, but it's useful as an intermediate step. It's execute P zero times, or execute P once, or execute P twice, or execute P three times, and so on. Okay? So it's any number of times. And then we have the one that really matters. From A until C loop B N. So this I'm using here the Eiffel syntax, but it's the usual loop with initialization in A, and then exit condition C and loop body B. So what is it? It's A followed by the execution of C of B any number of times, but only when C is not satisfied. So we are restricting it to C prime. And we restrict the results to results that satisfy C. So this is co-restriction. Right? And when one talks about loops, it's essential to talk as well about invariants. So here's the notion of invariant. First, the general notion of invariant, and then on the next slide, the notion of invariant for loops. So we said that a property is an invariant of a program if the postcondition preserves it. Remember that we are using this notation with the image, right? So an invariant of a program is a set of states such that if you apply the program post to it, to an element in that set, you're going to get a result which is also in that set. Okay, so that's to have a picture. Here's an invariant. So this is a set of states. Then we have an invariant I. And invariant means that whenever we apply the relation to an element in the set, we end up in that set. That's what it says here. Okay? If we apply post to I, then the result is in I. And we have an invariant refinement theorem, which I will skip. And now the notion of loop invariant. So who has seen loop invariants before? Okay, not too many people. You should never learn about loops without learning about loop invariants, including in this including outside of that context. So technically, a loop invariant is a subset of the codomain of A. So it's something that you get into which you get after executing the initialization, which is an invariant of B when applied only outside of C. And the correctness theorem here is that if we have a loop invariant, then the result is guaranteed to satisfy the invariant. So this is the fundamental property of loops. If we have a loop L, the results of L, L overline, right, the codomain, are going to satisfy the invariant, and they also satisfy the exit condition. That's what the loop is about. It preserves the invariant, and it gives us the exit condition. Okay, and yeah, how do we know that the loop is feasible? Well, we must have, in particular, that pose B is well-founded. So what's a well-founded set? For a certain relation, it's a set on which there is no infinite decreasing chain. So this corresponds to the standard notion of loop variant. That's how we prove that the loop terminates. Okay, finally, contracted programs. So I'm going to, I'm now in a position to reintroduce the distinction between programs and specifications. We can say that a program is an implementation of another. Then we have two programs. We have the program that serves as specification and a program that serves as implementation. And then we can have this last notation here, require, do, ensure, to say that P is an implementation of the given postcondition. And this is how we should be writing programs, always with a precondition. Okay. So yeah, this is a view of programming. A program is a proof obligation, right? To write a program is given pre-post to find P. So it's basically a proof obligation to show that pre-post has an implementation. And this is the way we can look at programs. Okay, so this is the theory. Programming is the process of devising interesting contract implementation pairs and discharging the associated proof obligations. Now, one thing I should have said at the beginning is that I have no idea whether this is useful or not. But I think it's a simple and elegant way to look at programming. So let me use the last few minutes to tell you a bit, to advertise a little bit for what for the rest of my work. Because as I said at the beginning, this is only part of what I do. And let me give you a very quick overview of other work. So at ETH and Innopolis. So there's work on verification. And verification, so here I'm going to need to organize myself a bit differently. Because I need a mouse. So the tool here that I would like to advertise for is AutoProof, which is a tool that we've built over the years with a number of PhD theses in particular, and it makes it possible to prove programs correct and its full correctness properties. So we don't just say that a program is not going to crash or it's not going to overflow or things like this. It's really that it's correct, for sequential programs at least. And it's available on the web, on the cloud. Here it is. So you can go, if I manage to get it right. Yeah, you can go to, you can just do as I did, you Google for AutoProof tutorial. And you, so this gives you, I hope, an idea of how it works. If I can just manage to click. No, I can't manage to scroll. But you basically what you have to do is to annotate programs. I'm sorry, it's completely unreadable. I have a problem here. Yeah, okay, this is better. So you see how it works, or you vaguely see how it works. It's a tutorial on the web, so you have to add your own annotations. Of course, you can approve programs without specifying what they have to do, and then it works directly on the cloud. So here, for example, it says add a loop invariant to prove to validate array accesses, and then you can click verify. So if I click verify here, since I've not done anything, it's not going to be able to verify it. It's running on a laptop in a student's office at the moment, so it's not very fast. But eventually, it will verify. I'll come back to it here it is, I believe. Right. So it can, at this point, what's green has been verified, and what's red, except that you don't see it's red. I can guarantee that this part on my screen, this part here, binary search is not verified. Okay, so that's one piece of work. And I think this is an important milestone in particular. The biggest thing that we have verified is an entire library of data structures and algorithms, Eiffel-based too, so stacks, queues. Yeah, I'm 3-4 minutes, and I'll be gone. I'll be done. We have verified, as part of the thesis of Nadia Padikarpova, we have verified an entire library, and as far as I know, this has not been done before. There's also dynamic verification with automatic tests. So there's a whole there's a tool called AutoTest and a tool called AutoFix. The idea of AutoTest is that it's really automatic testing. That is to say, it doesn't just automate the testing process like, say, JUnit style of tools, but it automates oracles and test case generation. So it's really push button testing. You can easily find it on the web. There's work on concurrency with a simple concurrency model called Scoop, which makes it much easier to write concurrent programs than anything I know. And it's also, there's work on robotics, with in particular this smart worker robot that we've developed and programmed to help elder people move around, to a kind of a smarter version of the workers they use. There's work on process. This is an opportunity to advertise for my book on agile methods, which is a critical analysis of agile methods, in which also Then there's work on language development, work on distributed development, and last comment, last observations. We've done an extensive work on teaching. In particular, I've been teaching the introductory programming course at ETH 13 times now. I'm still teaching it this semester. So I've been teaching it for a long time and developed an approach to introductory programming teaching, which uses contracts and objects right from the beginning, which a book which also exists in Russian as well. We're using it at Atinopolis too. And there's also four MOOCs altogether. So this was the first one, which anyone can take, and second one, so it's called Computing Art Magic Science. It corresponds to our course at ETH. It's available to anyone for free, of course, through edX. And what's particularly interesting about this course, and this is really, really the last thing I want to say, is that it's supported by some of the tools that we have developed in our group as part of the research on distributed development, in particular tools that make it possible to do programming assignments for students on the cloud. So you, as part of this course, you can... Yeah, I'm done. This is a typical exercise it's part of the course, right? If you take the course on the web, you are going to be presented with these exercises. And you know, one of the things that's difficult for beginning students is when you have a programming exercise to solve, to come up with all the context and the details. You need the control files, you need helper classes. So we do this for students, so here you can see in this exercise, we provide a class circle, we provide a class geometric shape, we provide a class rectangle, provide a class shape container. Actually, we don't. You see here, this is, it has your code here. I don't know how much you see it. So the student already has all the glue, all the context built for him. That's very easy for professional programmers, but for novices, it's really scary to have to prepare everything. Here it's done, and then you just, I don't know if I have enough space on the screen to do it, but you are going to click on compile and run. I have neither the space on the screen nor the time to do it, but you can imagine how it works. You click compile. If you have made compilation errors, you're going to get your compilation errors. Then you click run, and it's going to test the program against all the predefined tests. And it has completely changed our interaction with students, because previously when a student made a mistake and said, my program doesn't work, what do I do? Well, we had to let him send us his program by email, try to recompile it, but his context is different from ours and so on. It takes forever. Here, it just gives us the URL of the program using this tool, and we can see immediately what's wrong. So it's really a major advance for us in teaching programming. The tool is called CodeBoard, and it's available not just for Eiffel, it's available for Java, JavaScript, C++, another language. I'm not absolutely sure about the languages, but there's about a dozen languages for which it's available, and it's used in an increasing number of courses at ETH and in other universities in Europe and the US. Okay, and these are some of the places where you can go if you would like to have more information about what we do. And if there is any question, and if there is time for question, I'm not sure, I'm happy to take them.
У нас есть возможность задать несколько вопросов. Так, можно по-русски? Вот очень интересно было, когда вы проклассифицировали подходы к программированию, там функциональный, объектно-ориентированный. А можно вообще этот подход использовать как некую базу для классификации парадигм программирования? Парадигм сейчас очень много. И вот вопрос, какие парадигмы, значит, укладываются, и какие, как бы, они вообще, так сказать, за рамками этой теории оказываются?
Да.
Так, ну и насколько полные картины? Дело в том, что там сейчас же хаос, то есть количество парадигм, я даже не могу сказать сколько, там 20, 30, 40 там, в разных источниках.
Да, я это только делал для некоторых парадигм. Это слайд, который я очень коротко показал. Ну, это первая пробка. Не пробка, попытка, первая попытка, спасибо. И да, я ничего другого не делал. Но я думаю, что база здесь существует. И да, если функциональный язык, тогда всегда бывает, что что каждый результат находится в другом состоянии, в другом множестве состояний, чем первый. И если объект ориентированный, тогда есть пространство.
Мое опасение какое, что вот все это, грубо говоря, алгоритмический подход. Но программы, в принципе, бывают вот там настоящие логические программы. Это просто система уравнений, там нет никаких алгоритмов. Там, грубо говоря, нет состояния. Так что и вопрос, годится ли это или требуется некое, так сказать, вот что-то дополнительное для того, чтобы такую полную классификацию сделать.
Да, то, что я написал, это только базовая рамка, и совершенно возможно, что нужны другие математические рамки, но база, по-моему, применяется кому-либо
типу программирования. И, по-моему, это очень интересный предмет исследования.
Очень коротких еще несколько вопросов можно было.
А можно тоже по-русски спрошу? А правильно я понял, что представленная вами теория на самом деле может быть применима не только к программам, но к любым видам активности, которые что-то преобразуют в состояние, то есть с каким-то там другим физическим смыслом, какие-то производства, какие-то процессы и так далее. Спасибо.
Да, по-моему, да, но я совсем чистый нерд. И только заинтересовался до сих пор применениями к программированию. Но вы совсем правы, что рамка очень-очень общая, очень генеральная. И это было бы очень интересно видеть, как другие люди могут другие применения обработать. Да, ну, по моему мнению, как настоящий нерд, весь мир состоит из программ. Но кажется, что не все с этим еще не согласны. Да, да, но совершенно правильно, что здесь то, что не так важно то, что мы говорим о программах, которые исполняются на компьютере. Это может быть любой процесс.
Еще вопрос.
Здравствуйте.
Здравствуйте.
Значит, вопрос простой. Вот в теории хора и в вашем развитии, так сказать, ее, важное место занимают пред- и постусловия. Контрактный подход помогает, так сказать, частично сформулировать эти предусловия, но вручную. Знаете ли вы о каких-нибудь работах, которые позволяют в программах, а самое главное, в спецификациях, формировать пред- и постусловия автоматически?
Нет.
Вы очень коротко отвечаете, это здорово.
Да, я, конечно, могу подлиннее, но времени нет. Да,
One more question.
Thank you. So thank you for your presentation. I agree with that. You reach your objective. It's a more simpler and clear description of the theory of programs. Now, this is okay for the clean room development, but basically, how could you adapt your theory to dirty rooms, meaning specification and programs that are not related by refinement? As you know, you have sometimes specification programs, they can change and evolve independently and stay related by the fact that there are specification and programs of a project. So modifications of programs or specification which are not clean, as you said, how would you tackle program or specification modifications?
Donc bien entendu, je vais répondre en français. Bon, moi, je n'ai pas français, ce qu'il a. OK, it's a bullet shoot. Yes, it's a very interesting question. And actually, for me, this is quite to the point because I'm not at all a proponent of the top-down refinement-based approach. Actually, if you read some of my object-oriented work, it's rather strongly against this because, in fact, in practice, when you do refinement, you assume. I'll try to be very short. We can discuss this further. I'll just give you the basic answer. So yes, I'm not restricting myself to refinement. In fact, I don't like refinement that much because my view of programming is rather than you start from what you have. And then you build reusable components, and then you combine these reusable components in something interesting. So it's still the case that the notions are, I mean, whatever you do, whether you do it top down or bottom up, you still need to understand what you're doing. And a mathematical framework is the right one in both cases. Let me just add one more point here. For a long, long time,
I've had this problem with refinement-based approaches, that they assume that you start from a known problem and then you refine it into a program. And what I don't like about this is that the requirements will change. But finally, I think, thanks to a comment by Michael Butler, I think I understood how refinement can support change. And the comment he made, and that's really, 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 really my last point, the comment he made is that when you're making a change, invariance help. You can check whether the invariance still holds or not. And I think that's a very deep observation. Again, I'm indebted to Michael Butler for this observation. And I think that there is much more work to be done in this towards this goal of reconciling refinement-based and bottom-up reuse-based approaches.
Коллеги, у нас совсем-совсем нет времени, но может быть максимум один еще вопрос. Кто из вас? У кого короче?
Нет, важно. Важно не только, что вопрос был коротким, а что ответ коротким.
Вопрос такой.
Хорошо. Или может быть.
Существуют другие общие подходы к моделям программ, в частности, процессной алгебры, там, перечисления, логики всякие. Чем ваш подход лучше? Какие ваши преимущества, первое? Второе, вот программы, вашего подхода, что он позволяет делать то, что не позволяет делать другие подходы. И второе, существуют программы, в которых недетерминированно продаются параллельные процессы, MPI-программы, там неопределенное количество. Ваш подход может это вот, промоделировать?
Да. Окей, очень коротко. По-моему, самое большое преимущество – это просто, что подход очень простой, в смысле того, что, ну, может быть, трудно показать, что простой, потому что мне необходимо ввести некоторые сокращения, conventions, но все-таки простота лежит в том, что базовые понятия принадлежат только теории, элементарной теории множеств на уровне 15-летнего ученика. А что касается второго вопроса, это было еще... Да. Здесь очень просто. Я работаю с частными функциями, partial functions, частными функциями, да? Частичными функциями. А программа кончается только и только если только аргумент принадлежит domain области функции или relation. Значит, там лежит понятие конечности или termination, и но конечно все традиционные, все обычные результаты нерешительности еще применяются, конечно.
Спасибо. Еще раз давайте поблагодарим Бертрана.
Спасибо большое.